tune first, and then we'll... Good evening, everyone. It is great to see you all back. And I'm already all the past, guys. No, I wasn't here at all. It's great to be able to do this again in person. How many of you have been here before? So hopefully enough tradition that it feels like Christmas and maybe a few new songs along the way, new arrangements to keep the press. So welcome. One of the things we always do, just a little bit of fun, is we all of us kind of use it with different presents. Anybody here from Corey? Okay. Melody?
Yeah!
Babylon? St. Mary's? We got St. Mary behind you? Alright. Harrison? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came to be through Him, and without Him, nothing came to be. What came to be through Him was life, and this life of the human race. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. gods, but Christ, Lord of all, is still the one. The light shines in the darkness, and darkness did not overcome it. When I hear that line from the beautiful prologue to John's Gospel, I know that it's true, despite all the darkness still in the world. I don't know about you, but I can feel really pessimistic about the state of the world sometimes. It seems like it's full of violence and conflict wherever you look. Wars and mass shootings are in the news almost every day. And in addition to physical violence, there is also emotional violence in the form of sexism, racism, homophobia, and revenge, which can cause trauma for a person or a group of people. It all seems so much to bear at times. When I get stressed about all of it, I hold the tension and anxiety in my body, and it makes me always on edge, waiting for something bad to happen. But this world of conflict is not unique to those of us living here in the 21st century. The writer, Madeline Lingle, perhaps best known for her book, A Wrinkle in Time, has a beautiful poem called First Coming. It helps us remember that the world in which Jesus was born was also full of conflict. Here's the opening line. He did not wait till the world was ready, till men and nations were at peace. He came when the heavens were unsteady, and prisoners cried out for release. If God waited for the world to be at peace, the incarnation would never happen. Imagine, Mary and Joseph were living in an occupied territory. This wasn't a land at peace. They didn't control themselves. They lived under the threat of violence. So when Jesus said there was going to be a census, they had to travel, because not obeying the authorities would have brought terrible consequences. There was darkness then, just as there is now. So how do we look for light in a world full of darkness? One way that I invite you to pay particular attention to is longing. That sense deep within us that for something different than what we are currently living through. Our longings point us towards something, maybe even something we cannot name at this moment. But we recognize that longing that says something has to change. Something has to give. Enough is enough. The story of Christmas that we'll hear about tonight through word and through song is God responding to that longing. In the spiritual exercise of St. Ignatius, we're asked to pray by imagining the divine Trinity looking at earth, looking at all the individual people in their complex relationships. Some life-giving, some awful, some just ordinary. God hears all the longings in our hearts that seek peace. This moment of the looking at all the darkness and all of us is when God responds to our longings with the greatest in the midst of so many unknowns, uncertainties, comes the long-awaited Messiah. Not as a conqueror of hero, but as a fragile and helpless baby, born into a world at war. And still, we have these deep longings. We long because the promise of peace that Jesus has already fulfilled has not yet entered into all of our hearts. And that's okay. The final words of Madeline Lingle's poem tells us why. We cannot wait till the world is saying,
to raise our songs with vocal voice, for to share our grief, to touch our pain, to dream with love, rejoice, rejoice. To dream with love, rejoice, rejoice. The longing that is in within each of us, the longing for peace, for an end to war, for an end to oppression, for love, for reconciliation, for healing, for justice, for mercy. That longing points our way through the uncertainties of life, through the unknowns of the future, through the darkness of the experience. That longing is responding to the light of Christ, here and now, and that reason that exists.
the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And coming to her, he said, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at what he said, and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High, and the Lord will give him the throne of David his father, and he will rule over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." But Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I have not yet had relations with a man?" And the angel said to her in reply, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, Son of God." Mary said, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Now when Joseph was betrothed found out that Mary was the child through the Holy Spirit, he became deeply distressed. However, since he was a righteous man and the religious was exposed to the shame, he decided to divorce her quietly. Such was his intent that, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary your wife into your home, for it is through the Holy Spirit that the child has been conceived in her. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save all people from their sins." And this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said to the prophet, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us." But Joseph awoke, he did as the angel had commanded him, and he took Mary into his home.
So Joseph took Mary, and together they went up from Galilee to Judea to the city of David that is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David. While they were there, the time came for her to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them.
Thank you.
Now, there were shepherds in that region, living in the fields and keeping the night watch over their flock. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with great fear. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was a multitude of angels, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to those on whom God's favor rests." Then the angels went away from them to heaven, and the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem to see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went in haste, found Mary and Joseph, and the infant lying in the manger.
in the days after Jesus had been born in Bethlehem, the old magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw the star just rising, and have come to give him homage." Now, when King Herod heard this, he was greatly troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. So Herod called the magi secretly, and ascertained from them the time of the star's appearance. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go, and search diligently for the child. When you have found him, bring me word, that I too may go and do him homage." After their eyes were the king, they set out. And behold, the star that they had seen at its rising preceded them, until it came and stopped over the place where the child was. They were overjoyed at seeing the star, and, on entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and Joseph. The magi prostrated themselves and did him homage. Then they opened their treasures and offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and
singing praises to God for all that they have heard and seen. The men depart, after offering their gifts, gathered them, and having been warned and entombed by God not to return to Herod, departed for their country by another way. Now, after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Go, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt. Remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child and destroy him." Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and fled to Egypt and returned there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet Hosea, "Out of Egypt I have called my son."
Thank you.
Mary and Joseph remained in Egypt until an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel. For those who were seeking the child's life were dead." Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to Galilee. There they made their home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called the Nazarene. And Mary and Joseph kept all these things reflected on them in their hearts.
Thank you.
let the rock of Christmas begin as we pray together. Too many people face each day sad, hungry, homeless, or poor. Too often, people feel division and exclusion instead of following the dreams of Jesus. Let us pray during this Advent season that Christ's love lead us out of darkness and into light, giving us the power to be the light for us.
Those who are in serious illnesses, and those who pray for others, that they may have the faith to
they may enter the kingdom of heaven amid songs of joy and gladness. To your families and friends who grieve these losses, that they can receive consolation for the love and support of their family members and friends. Just a few announcements and some thank yous. First, to Father Frank Mass, who started this tradition 37 years ago. Frank, would you stand? The location and the format has changed over the years, but we've got that to go. Oh, my goodness. You know my name? Oh my gosh, it's Santa Claus! We've been looking for you. What? Where? Hey, eggnog, you lost? Santa, where were you? Of course. Well, we're glad that you're here. After our event this evening, we wanted Santa to be here for Deck the Heights so that we can have the picture taken with him over in Ruin. So I guess you guys can head over there, and after we sing Silent Night, we'll join us. Thanks, Santa. Oh,
As I was saying a few thank yous, to Andrew Steph for gracing the campus and LSPD, the campus life and leadership, the team here in campus ministry, the Office of Alumni and Parent Engagement, who are responsible for accepting and creating a token of our appreciation attended this evening, events management, security, physical plan, our visual and performing arts department, the Joyful Noise e-board, Father Odute for presiding and Father Jason for his wonderful honor. There are a few people that deserve a special thanks. How many of you saw the live stream last year? Okay, some of you. That was a real gift to the community. I think that video is over 3,000 views. That would not have been possible without the hard work of who I call the, the Bluetooth band, who you saw this evening perform Christ Our Life Has Come. And they've been working behind the scenes this evening as well. Andrew is behind us running the sound. Sebastian is in the control room here running the live stream. And Matt Wojak, who has been producing this event for months, is up here in the choir. Would you stand and Sebastian, I guess, just deliver wherever you are? They've been here for hours, Saturday night, Sunday, testing lights, doing sound, running tables, taking things. This would not have happened without them. I know that you were probably holding applause all through the evening for the amazing resistance that you heard behind me. So let's take a moment. It was a joy to have some soloists who probably many of you know, some who you may not, the little ones were my own children. Father Michael Gillespie, the priest who is honored over it, was from the class of 1995. He did one of the meetings, several community members, faculty, staff, administrators, and seconds, so all of you who participated, thank you. On Wednesday, December 8th, it is a holy day, the Immaculate Conception. We go off of Mass here at noon. Crafting with Campus Ministry will hold its last event this Thursday, so if you're looking to reduce the stress, students will be in dresser. Sister Anna is making her homemade MCs. If you took a tag from our wish tree, please remember to return it unwrapped before you head home for break. We're also accepting monetary donations this evening to help us purchase small personal care items for those who are in need during the holiday season. The collection boxes are at the entrance. And following our final hymn, you're all invited over to Tour 4, Deck the Hearts, featuring Christmas cupcakes and cocoa, make your own gingerbread houses, stuff a buddy, which is kind of gingerbread, giveaways and more, and of course, pictures with Santa and Edna. And Iggy, as you pass by the doors, please return your candles to the red bucket or to someone who's behind the doors. And please pick up a special 75th commemorative anniversary ornament from the alumni office. To thank you for coming and commemorate this special year. And it's certainly on behalf of all of us here, and we wish all of you a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We hope that you will join us in our closing song, Night of Silence and Silent Night. When the men in the choir sing Silent Night, I'll turn around and feed you. You'll sing Silent Night when the choir finishes Night of Silence. So please sing. And thanks for coming. Drive safe.
Cool and peaceful.
his cousin brother. May the peace of Emmanuel be with you now and always. As we conclude our time together, let us offer each other some signs.